Very good afternoon, dear participants and Dr. Tomar. We come to the fifth lecture of this module on applications of radioisotopes in healthcare. We are going to concentrate today on radiotherapy, which is an important, if not the most important, wing of the entire field called radiation oncology. We have been seeing a large number of radioisotope sources related applications. So today's in current scenario, there are certain amount of security related information to be shared regarding such sources. Without that, it will not be complete. So even though it might not be specifically highlighted in the syllabus, I have chosen to have a small component towards the end of today's lecture on the security of the radioactive sources and allied matters. So that's going to be the overall theme. And we come to what's the today's main part or the burden. Cancer, as we know, is an extremely cruel disease. It's supposed to be accounting for almost 16% of all the deaths. And with longevity increasing, the number of people living with cancer or having cancer is also growing, because there are probability of getting certain cancers are proportionately increasing with advanced age. As you advance age, the probability increases almost order of magnitude more. While in the kind of strategies to manage the whole thing, obviously prevention to the best extent possible and the earliest possible diagnosis, that's also again likely to help, you know, have a very early treatment. But ultimately, that you discovered it very early or very late, the actual cancer patients living with cancer, they have to be treated. And that treatment includes this important component of radiation also. It is not that the radiation is the only thing. We have other systems, and as we will see through this lecture, invariably all are collectively needed. Like, it's not one versus the other. You need practically all the three. And that's the important part, like, to remember in this whole thing. Like, the radiotherapy is the clinical modality for cancer treatment using the radiation. This radiation can come from the radioisotopic source. That is why this is part of current lecture module. It could also be coming from X-rays and electrons, which are obtained from machine sources. So we have the scope for both radioisotope linked and the machine generated radiation, and that clinical modality, radiotherapy, has played an extremely vital role in the management of cancer patients. It's not a panacea, it's not curing everybody, but it's a very, very important component, and that's the reason. The field of radiation oncology, the word many would have heard, is the larger medical discipline. It includes many other aspects beyond the radiotherapy alone, and everywhere the use of radiation will be there. That's why it is in the cancer management angle, many, many subjects part, wherever radiation is used, that is the radiation oncology itself. I mentioned to you that radiation is important, but it is not the only one which is used with along with other things. Like, that's why it's very important. It's extensively used alone and combination, depending on the particular patient and the particular type of the cancer they have. By and large, wherever possible, a cancer tumor will be removed surgically. Therefore, surgical oncology or surgery becomes a very key component. But certain places may not be possible to be easily be done, subjected to a surgery. Then you have only a kind of a medication. The medication can be a chemopharmaceutical, it can be a hormone, it can be an antibody. So that is collectively called systemic treatment. In earlier times, people used to call with the word chemotherapy. It's only the chemical pharmaceutical, so use the word chemotherapy. But today there are hormones, antibodies, so many things are being used. So we use a more general word, systemic treatment, which means you are intravenously or orally administering the drug, and then it's going, and that's the actual part. And then, of course, our radiation part, which is there. Just to give a statistics, this is what is widely quoted, including at the WHO end, and therefore I have tried to include 50% of the cancer patients would have required radiotherapy at some point of their disease management. It's not the only one, but along with surgery or along with the systemic therapy, they would have received that. That's what is said. And the burden is very huge. One of the survey types says greater than 18 million new cancer cases are registered annually. This is a 2018 data, which could be a little bit more now. And there are about 9 million of them, the patients will be needing radiotherapy every year. That's the kind of the large volume. And in India, the number was stated as around 1.4 million cases in the year 2020. Basically, we are using the ionizing radiation because of the property that the radiation energy deposited causes biochemical changes. It causes cellular damage by damaging the DNA and leading to cell killing at a suitable appropriate dose levels. Like, this is the basic property which we are using, and the radiation used is predominantly gamma rays, X-rays, and electrons. They are the ones which are predominantly used. I would like to acknowledge right at the beginning that much of the technical clinical information comes from Dr. Elena Fedorova of World Health Organization and one of the very senior medical physicist, radiation physicist, Dr. Govindarajan of PSG Hospital. He was an ex-DA staff also. They are the two whose mastery and their main articles have been profusely used in putting together the slide material for your current knowledge and information part of it. Having said that the radiation destroys the cells, we need to know that we are not only able to do it on the tumor alone. Naturally, all the cells around the tumor will also be receiving that radiation. However focused we may be about with radiation, it will affect the cells, normal cells around that. That's the entire tricky business, because you have to maximize the dose to the tumor, still ensure as much minimally possible. And again, there could be a situation where a procedure may not be possible at all because the proximity to some critical cells or critical organ can be so close, then you will not be able to use it. In addition to gamma X-ray and electrons, we are also using protons and heavy ions type of the thing in the treatment. We will have just one slide towards the end. The biological effect will depend on the type of radiation, total dose, and how, you know, if total dose is X, you are not giving the X in one go. We are giving it in several fractions of 0.X like. So therefore, that all will be actually doing it. The principle of that can be very nicely followed by going for a kind of an analogy arrangement. This figure shows you the probability of the tumor control with the radiation dose here. And that's the dark line. So after some level of a dose, there is a tumor control thing starts taking place, and then you are reaching to a near maximum of your ability to do the tumor control. But at the same time, the normal cells are also having, or the complications can be there. Fortunately, they invariably start with a little bit of a still further higher doses, like, because the cancer cells are more susceptible to the radiation. And that's an advantage. But the normal cells, again, depending on the cancer, which part of the organ we are talking about, this gap can be very, very small. This so-called window, which is there between us, if you call it the therapeutic window or therapeutic ratio, this will vary. And but that's the critical part which we are trying to use there. So for a given radiation dose, like, you know, if you take that, we will be able to reduce the complications if we are getting a better kind of a ratio. This principle is what is very, very important. And this gap, it's real, it exists, but it is not fixed or one quantity. And therefore, as a principle to explain, I have used that. But depending on individually, each type of the cancer or so, like, there can be very big differences. And in quite a few, there can be quite close overlap, in which case you cannot be using the radiation there because the normal damage or the complication is likely to be much more. Then such a case, we say, is not amenable to the particular radiotherapy. So this is part of the bottom of the principal part of it, and it is that which helps you to have the whole thing like. So both cancer and normal cells will be exposed, the normal cells to the minimum possible extent, depending on the system of treatment you do. But we are banking on the point that the better survival capability of the normal cells. And in fact, that's what makes the radiation therapy work. The normal cells will also be extremely sensitive, and they would also be immediately killed. Like, there would not be a branch like the radiotherapy at all for you. And nature's gift, like, the normal cells have a better resilience. They are able to survive, and that's used. And you are also trying to do by all means, physical as well as certain other means, like, to minimize the exposure to the normal cells surrounding the tumor tissues. The basic unit of radiation, the absorbed dose arrangement, that is the energy per gram of the medium, like if you take the famous word gray, 1 gray is 1 joule per kg. Gray was the scientist whose work was honored by giving that unit. It's 1 joule per kg is what is called the 1 gray dose. Like, you typically use around 60 to 100 gray of dose, which are considered really very, very large. But that will not be given in one go, because we want to take advantage of the normal cells to survive the minimal damage to the cells around. And for that sake, this 60 to 100 is always given in fraction. 60 is also a large range, that is depending on the tumor size and also on how advanced the treatment mode is. The more advanced the treatment mode is, you are, that means, able to give much more dose only to the tumor. That's what is known as the advanced treatment mode. The more advanced treatment mode it is, you will be able to give the calculated maximum, what we call the tumorosoidal dose, to the tumor. But if the advanced treatment mode is not that advanced, in order to save the normal cells, you will have to come to a suboptimal. You will go to a little lesser dose rather than to the highest. So these are all the tricks which the medical physicist, the radiation physicist, dosimetrist do along with the doctor in planning every one of those medications. Again, the chances of the normal cell survival is increased by giving smaller fractions of the dose. That's why we are using always the dose in fractionated manner. If you have any unfortunate relative who has had cancer, they are going for radiotherapy, you will hear they have to keep going every day of the week for a few weeks, several weeks together. Like, the reason is precisely this: around 1.8 or 2 gray per fraction is given in a sitting, like that, 5 days a week, 4 or 5 weeks or 5 or 6 weeks, depending on what is the type of tumor, cancer. The clinician and the medical radiation physicist, they decide, and then the therapy is delivered to them. In this kind of a number of fractions, what is called the conventional fractionation or some specialized fractionation protocols are also there. This helps give better scope for the normal cells to recover, and therefore your ability to utilize the radiotherapy is very much increased. So this is one of the tricks which was very early on worked out, and that methodology is being used irrespective of whatever is your radiation source. I told you the radiation source can be two things: a radioisotope like cobalt 60, or it could be the electrons or X-rays type of radiation can also be used. And this constitutes what we call the fundamental principles. So there is a large dose to be given in a fractionated manner over very, very large number of the sittings. Second thing is, what's the kind of the intent? What type of a radiotherapy? There are radiotherapies to be given, attempted at the curative itself. That's what ideally one would like, because you would like to ensure that the patient is cured of the cancer. But life is not that simple. It's not possible to all the time have absolute curative. There are people who are suffering quite a large amount of pain to do with spinal cord compression. They may be having bleeding, etc. And a palliative treatment is also possible for these people. You may recall we talked about in nuclear medicine bone scanning, because I mentioned to you many tumors spread to the bone, their secondaries, metastasis, and that's why there is a severe bone pain. But if that is focal in a couple of places alone in the body of the patient, you don't have to do a nuclear medicine therapy of the bone specific radiopharm, therapeutic radiopharmaceutical. Instead, such a patient is subjected to external radiation, like in this case we will be seeing. And that's what is called the palliative part. And there are also the curative. And how do you administer in relation to the other modalities? There are, in some cases, the first will be like the before the surgery, the tumor is, seems to be like relatively large. And the doctor, they call it the cancer board, which involves the surgeon, the medicine doctor, treatment, and the radiation specialist. They discuss the patient case and decide that it would be necessary to first shrink the tumor a bit. So let's give some radiation. And thereafter, after the tumor has shrunk a bit, then we will perform the surgery. That's called actually a neoadjuvant type of a radiotherapy arrangement. Another is, which is the more common one, is the adjuvant, where the surgeon first performs and removes the tumor mass. That's the surgery is done. And subsequently, because you will not be able to 100% completely scoop up all the part of the tumor in many cases, the remnant tumor part is given the radiation in order to destroy the remnant tumor cells. Like the adjuvant mode is probably the much, much larger mode, like where neoadjuvant is also becoming necessary, but that already implies the tumor had been far too large. The patient might have been in an already advanced stage, but still not to go without giving a chance to the patient. The radiation is given to reduce the tumor size, and then a surgery is set up. The corollary is to these two, in between, you can almost attempt intraoperatively. That means you have done the surgical thing like to remove the main tumor. The remnants also, can it be in situ there itself radiation treated? This may not be that very readily possible in all cases, but procedurally, yes, there is an intraoperative radiotherapy is also available. That's why I said the timing of the RT administration, either it is after the, as a prelude to the surgery, neoadjuvant, after the surgery, adjuvant, or intraoperative. And the intent, which is the curative or palliative, they are the two types of radiotherapy. And mind you, this is always there along with chemotherapy might be given, then we call it the chemo radiation. The person could be getting antibody therapy, which is called the immunotherapy. So it's never like alone. The very important message to take is it's not one versus the other. Depending on the individual tumor case, the cancer case, and the patient part of it, like multiple modes will be required, and that is all what is done. Now we come to what are the two major types of the radiotherapy arrangement itself. That's in a very simple word, like teletherapy or external beam radiotherapy, and then brachytherapy. Tele, as the word means, the distant. So the radiation is coming from a distant to the body. Brachy is like near or proximal. So in the brachytherapy, the radiation is very close to the tumor part itself. These become the two major methods of the delivering the radiotherapy. But teletherapy is the more larger, common, or much more widely used thing for a variety of tumors, because as you know, brachytherapy by the word, it means nearer to the tumor. We will see some example. It may not be possible in all cases. Now, in the teletherapy mode, at a distance, the radiation coming itself, once again, we have these two modes. One is our called 60, the 5.27 year half-life, 1.17 MeV and 1.33 MeV gamma emission. The two twin gamma emission of the high value, like, and that deep penetration and the availability of the cobalt 60. This is what actually made the teletherapy first emerge. The other alternate mode of electrons or the X-rays, they came later. In fact, X-ray usage was there even earlier, but using energetic electrons in a linear accelerator to have the radiation, that came much later. X-rays were probably there very early on also. So unlike cobalt, this was also there available. So in both these cases, the radiation is generated in a particular head, and through an opening, which is kind of a collimator arrangement, a beam comes through the air, enters the body of the patient. And depending on the positioning, the treatment planning carried out by the medical physicist, the calculations are done. They know exact angle, how to position the patient. These are all involving a very, very huge amount of science. For very simplicity, we say there is a machine gives the radiation, the patient is positioned, the radiation goes for a few moments, and then the dose is given that day, the patient is sent off. Again, the next day, the patient comes. But in actual practice, enormous amount of work and the quality assurance system taking place, everything like takes place, and eventually it comes. The difference between the cobalt and radiation will be cobalt 60, whether you are using it or not, is radioactive. So it has to be protected. So it will have to have a lead shielded container array. Whereas with the electron or X-rays, only when the machine is on, there is radiation coming. And when the machine is off, there is no radiation. This is the big difference. And because of that, the cobalt 60 source related requires a specialized arrangement and doing. And similar way here, when the electron or X-ray is emitted, this is again a high energy radiation area. So once again, you will need some shielding and all that for the operator and the other patient's relatives to be outside there. Like, whereas here, the source permanently is containing the radioactivity there. And that has its some issue, which is what we are going to talk towards the end of the talk on what is called the security of the radioactive sources. What about the brachytherapy? Here, the RI source of radiation is placed in a patient's body very proximal to the tumor. It could be near the skin part of it. It could be in a natural body cavity, like especially in the cancer of the females, for example, the uterus cancer, cervix cancer, etc. Those kind of a part between the skin, tissue layers of the skin, That's where the interstitial breast cancer, or even on the skin surface, it could be there. Like, the source can be taken in a planned manner closest to the tumor and taken out. And that is what is called the brachytherapy. We are going to see individually each one of them in little more detail. So therefore, we don't have to right now worry. The very first part is related to the cobalt 60. We are on the radioisotope usage. So we will cover that part of it in a very great manner. And it goes to the credit of a physicist of Canada, Harold Johns, in 1950s. He created, otherwise till then it was only radium type of isotope being attempted for the cancer treatment, which had its own lot of issues. So he conceived of this idea of the cobalt's powerful gamma emissions to be used, and having a shielded arrangement and an opening possibility to get the cobalt's radiation out. And that technology development, it has of course undergone tremendous evolutionary change, much, much more sophistication in technology, equipment, system, controls, everything like, but basic principle still remains the same. And that was in the 50s when he first did that first unit. Just to be showing the Indian pride for that, like, the very first one such unit was in Cancer Institute, Madras. Madras was Madras at the time. It was not Chennai like today, as early as in 1956. Within few years, we had, that means, you know, the awareness, the cancer problem, and a kind of an emerging technology as of at the time, its utility was well known and it was extremely well utilized. That makes us feel very proud. Many advanced countries only would have had it at that type of time, and India had one such thing like it. So in the actual practice, after the calculated amount, what we are giving like will be several tens of gray. I told you anywhere around 60 to 100 gray, and the same thing is what is meant as several tens, and it comes in a fractionated manner, and each one being around 1.5 to 2 gray like per each of the city. This has been the workhorse, you can say, for most of the radiation therapy of cancer patients, not just in India, the world over, including in some very less developed countries. This had been there, and even today it is in use in a limited way in many parts of the world, and it is still very useful. But as we will see, there are some distinct advantages in the electron based, the LINAC systems, like, both with reference to efficacy and safety. But cobalt 60 model is still cost effective. It's relatively less complex compared to the electron accelerator arrangements, and therefore it's still preferred in many of the resource constrained type of countries, particularly the developing nations. The important source here is the cobalt 60 of the order of 5,000 to 12,000. It will, to begin with, it will be around 10,000 to 12,000 curies, that is 10 to 12 kilocurie. And because of the radiation decay, as we said, over 5 years, 10 years, it could come down. And initially, you need a very, very high specific activity, because the source itself, we would like to be extremely tiny. Then only the radiation power, the radiation output to the full configuration you need can be obtained. And that makes the specific activity requirement to be very high. If you have this kind of a specific activity over 250 curie per gram and around 10 to 12,000, the radiation field given by the cobalt 60 will be large enough, of the order of 150 to 200 Rontgen per minute at 1 m. So this had a famous unit called RMM. That was a kind of a thumb rule figure. You need that, then only the treatment can be planned, because at each sitting, the patient cannot be asked to sit for pretty long time. They have to be given a very small time exposure, because they are already uncomfortable patients, and telling them to be still, you know, you don't want the other parts of the body to get the dose. So when you are asking the patient to remain absolutely still as they receive the radiation, the barest minimum time is what is the maximum needed. And that makes it mandatory that you need to have a certain adequate amount of the radiation output from there. And that fixes the amount of total radioactivity as well as the specific activity part. Of course, because of the half-life arrangements, every 5 to 10 years, the source will have to be replaced. Then along with that, there are some operational challenges. These are some of the downside of the cobalt 60, but it was available and it had remained the workhorse all through the things. The technology developments wise, nice looking gantry like this had been possible. And this is the counterweight, because the shielding is there and it's very heavy. In order to balance that, you will have a counterweight arrangement. And a lot of advances technologically, whatever could be done has been done, and that results in giving as efficacious a therapy as possible, even with the fixed amount of the radiation dose coming and gradually changing with time. what was the dose 3 months back will not be the same today because the radiation output would have decayed by 3 months. So time calculation readjustments will have to be done. These are continuously being done by the medical physicist. Fortunately, because of the half-life of the cobalt 60, you don't necessarily have to do it on an everyday basis, any adjustment. But adjustments once in about a month like will be needed to re-ascertain the radiation field and work out how it is. And generally at about 80 centimeter to 1 meter distance will be the distance of the radiation source to the patient, the movement of the radioactive beam, how much distance it travels and comes. The source head itself is a very heavily shielded one, lung, it will be with lead, the tungsten, that kind of a thing will be there. And also, you are not, you know, if it is directly open all the time, dose will be coming. So you need to keep the source in a place and should be able to move it in order to release the beam light. This kind of an arrangements again have undergone multiple technological improvements. Therefore, safety will be highest assured. That is, the source will always remain in a totally shielded safe method without any scope for giving further radiation so that everybody can access this room, do all the work. And after the positioning of the patient, everything is done like using remotely the means and nowadays, including the computer help, the thing will be released and there is a release mechanism of the source to be brought here and then the radiation comes through this opening onto the patient. These kind of developments, etc., have all been done. And it lets you have again like certain type of, depending on how you have kept the small collimator around there, 5x5 or 30x5, 35 up to that level of square. Mostly it is square or rectangular geometry is what will be possible with the collimator. Very recently, some technology development of having some different contours because, you know, yeah, tumor is not exactly a square or rectangular one. It could be of any shape. So you need certain additional advantages. This has been more difficult with a cobalt 60 based, whereas with a linear accelerator based, that collimator readjustments have been also an additional advantage possible. But telecobalt machines have been the workhorse. They still continue to be very heavily, very largely used. Like, but the alternative, the LINAC system, they have become important because you need, you know, the energy of cobalt is fixed. So its penetrability is fixed. Now, there could be a tumor which is somewhat closer to the end, you know, skin part where through the radiation goes, or something could be much deeper. So, in a different patients, you may need to have different depths of penetration of the radiation will be required. And also, there is this variability of the cobalt 60 thing depending on the total strength of the dose and its peak. These will be removed if you have an electron-based type of a radiation coming, because you will be able to adjust the energy, which means you are adjusting the penetrability, and you will also be able to enhance or increase the intensity, which means you are able to get the higher level of radiation output. These advantages, which could be conceived in using electron-based radiation, made the linear accelerator as an additional attractive proposition for actually doing the cancer treatment. It all started with cobalt. But sensing what is affecting it or what are the deficiencies, are there any other means? This is again radiation, but it's not a radiation coming from radioisotope. It's coming from the charged particle. So the requirements of higher energy so that different depths of penetration could be managed, higher outputs of radiation. Instead of linking only to the 10-12 kilocuries of cobalt 60 and what it can give as a tiny source as the total radiation, you will be able to do this. And this had actually increased the need for it. And also because of that, you can now reduce the treatment duration. I mentioned to you that the patient, you can't ask them to hold on for a long time. You would like to keep them to the barest minimum. Once again, that is major advantage when you are using the LINAC. So all these 3-4 advantages put together, the LINACs have overtaken completely the telecobalt. And in most of the industrialized or Western world, practically very little cobalt 60 based telecobalt usage is there, but it is still there in a number of other parts of the world, including developing countries and other places. Like, it's not anything is bad with the cobalt, the other one is much superior. In the absence of any other treatment, a cobalt based treatment is still very helpful for the cancer patients. It should be continued to be given. But wherever they are able to have an access to a better modality, you tend to go with the other superior methodology like it. So that's the actual thing. It actually produces a pencil beam, very narrow electron beam like, and then you have a very high atomic number target, which creates the Bremsstrahlung, the breaking radiation, and the continuous X-rays type are produced. And the two typical energies used are the 6 and 10 MV mega voltage machines, and two particular models, the Varian Linac model, and another one is Electa of another Holland company. Between those two probably company models itself, practically a very large amount of the Linac systems of the world are used. Even though we are dealing with radioisotopes, we will continue with that. Without the Linac mentioning, the topic will be incomplete. So we are just seeing a glimpse, only one, but it's absolutely very, very, an unfair treatment to the whole field, because this is a complete topic by itself. What about our indigenous cobalt therapy unit, telecobalt? Have we had one? We did not have, and we did not have for a very, very long time. I told you 1956 Cancer Institute in Madras got one of the gift or whatever it is, cobalt unit there. The only technical institute which could take up is naturally BRC. There was the interest, the doctors asking and so on. And finally, around 90s, there was some technology development effort. 2005, your first model came. They called it the Babatron, and with some advances, superiority of that, a second model came up in 2007, which is called the Babatron 2, and that's the model machine like you are seeing here. And this is the head with the radiation source there, and accidentally that was one of the machine systems at the Tata Memorial Center, where our ex-president Abdul Kalam ji was visiting, and it's a picture around that. And it's a machine which has been given by the Indian government through the IAEA to Vietnam. And the IAEA representative is here, and this is the machine So ultimately, a technology development wise, we came and we have a machine. But as I said, by this time, the world has almost completely switched over to the Linac. So the Linac effort is also needed from India. But the BRC's efforts in developing this technology, and technology taken over by a Bangalore-based company, Panacea Medical Systems, their website is here. They have been extremely good. In fact, this is the person from that institute, and they have done technical value addition. They continue to do it also, including, as I said, in some of the collimators. So we have a model of the telecobalt, but our own major medical institutes in India would today prefer mostly the Linac, because that is the kind of the cutting edge technology. And currently in India, what we have as per the AERB record is only around 175 or 180 telecobalt units, whereas around 500 Linac units are already in India. But these numbers may look big, but that's not very large. Taking our Indian population, we need something of the order of greater than 1,250 such units. By taking 1 million KLA, at least one unit is available for with reference to doing the treatment means. You need much, much more. And currently, there is a huge disparity. Some major cities may have multiple machines, others will not have. This should be some kind of a thought-provoking one, because I'm making one of the assignment linked to that to make you think, imagine, what would you do if you are given a free hand in order to improve upon the teletherapy mode, radiotherapy mode for cancer patients. Just like BRC took up the telecobalt development, one of the DOE's independent unit called the SAMIR, it's a microwave electronics specialized institute. They have actually developed an indigenous Linac. They call it Siddharth, but it's not gone to that level of development as the Babatron had gone. But there is some literature available, website information. But any one of them will have to be taken in a much more greater manner in our Indian condition, because our requirements are very large. This is a picture of about 5 years back information. The blue color ones are the linear accelerators. You can see the tremendous high increase. Because of the popularity and their greater advantage, the cobalt which was already there, it's more or less stabilized arrangement, it's not there. And the brachytherapy, again, we'll just be touching on that topic. We'll again bring back this slide. The brachytherapy numbers have also gone up. But as I said, the numbers we need are almost 4 times more than what we are currently having. Certain strategies are needed to arrange and adjust that. We move to the brachytherapy mode, where the source, radiation source radioactivity, the radioisotope part, is brought in a certain geometry very closely placed to the tumor target volume, wherever possible. It may be possible in the case of a breast cancer, or it could be possible in the case of some of the facial type of a cancer in this patient's case, or a breast cancer here, or much more common in our Indian setting is for the female cervix. Cervical cancer is something very, very problematic one. In all that this very early on, the technology was actually a manual arrangement of the source movement and back positioning, having originally located the tumor, the imaging and the treatment planning done precisely to that spot. The tubes insertion is all done. And then finally, the source is driven through the channel in the tube arrangement from the central console machine into the actual tumor sites. Like, such sophisticated brachytherapy system equipment are currently still required to be imported. Again, the two companies, Varian and Elekta, have somewhere around 300 to 500 gigabecquerels of the radioactivity can be there. Then they give you what we call high dose rate, because we want to keep the minimal time of exposure to the patient. So we need a certain high level of the dose rates, like. And the source used here is iridium-192, 74-day half-life. The gamma energy is about 300 kV or 0.3 MeV, and that's the source strength which is used. And it's also possible to use the cobalt-60, but the cobalt-60 is gamma being the much higher penetrability, which was an advantage in the telecobalt, is actually a disadvantage in the brachytherapy, because here you do not want the radiation to be going far too beyond the tumor to the other body sites. And that is how iridium with the 300 keV is much more preferred. But because of the half-life of 74 days, the source replacement will have to be much more frequently done. Again, it's a trade-off. Energy is favorable, but half-life-wise, you need to actually have the source replacement. And also computationally, every week decay will mean something significant. So for the patient treatment, all those adjustments will have to be done. But thankfully, we have very good medical physics, radiation physics based specialization people. They are taking care of it. Now in the brachytherapy, again, like as we said, in the case of breast and all, it may be the interstitial and intracavitary for the cervical cancer type, like. And in the interstitial, you can have either a temporary implant. That means, you know, you are only inserting it for a given duration and you have removed it, like, whereas in the case of a, particularly in the case of a prostate cancer, the implant of the radioactivity made may be left behind there itself for a long time. And then that is called actually a permanent implant. So you have both removable temporary implants as well as the permanent implants. And depending on the dose level, like the high dose rate, medium dose rate, much of the time, the permanently left one will always be invariably be a low dose rate one, and therefore they continuously keep giving the radiation for a much longer time. Whereas the temporary ones and the intracavitary ones are invariably the medium level or the high dose level part of it, like. And the bulk of it, like, what are the isotopes that's shown on the right side? The historic reason why this particular professor's table contained everything I have included, we do not use anymore the radium-226. Cobalt is much less. Cesium practically given up. It was used for the low dose rate therapy, not much. Iridium-192 is actually the kingpin now for much of the high dose rate brachytherapy systems. This is used. And for a very low dose rate permanent implant, iodine-125 like is also used. From very sophisticated equipment type system, one seen here, like, multiple types of facilities are available. And one is being done by the BRC, DAE's unit, Board of Radiation Isotope Technology. One such brachytherapy system for the high dose rate, they are actually developing, which will be helpful for replacement or import substitution for the Elekta or Varian machines. The much earlier times, they had the low dose rate cesium and iridium based units that supplied, but they are now no more necessary. And manual loading arrangement units, which were there, they are also now completely lost, because this remote afterloading is what is actually preferred, so as to announce about the safety, both with reference to the patient as well as with reference to operating people, etc. I'm just bringing back the same slide which I showed you in the other case, this time only to show on the brachytherapy. You can again see the last 15 years. This is essentially the growth period of the private healthcare system in our country in a very large way growing. And those corporate large hospitals, cancer treatment systems, many of them have imported units. Today, we have more than 300 brachytherapy units in India. Therefore, on a computational method, you can roughly say about 60,000 patients per year are getting treated by the brachytherapy arrangement, whereas the number of cases being treated with the cobalt-60 can be virtually be the teletherapy mode can nearly be one order of magnitude more, if not still higher than that. But just to put at least some order of magnitude idea, you can carry that message of at least an order of magnitude. There has been a large amount of interest in beyond the radiotherapy two systems we talked about, the telecobalt based or LINAC based one on the external beam radiotherapy or the brachytherapy. These are also brachytherapy, but very low dose rate and for some very, very specific areas of cancer. One of the type is actually related to the eye, where in this picture, I do not know whether you are able to see there, like to the back of the eye, like there is a tumor shown here, and there is a kind of a patch of a thing, which is actually the radioactivity plague. Very, very tiny radioactive sources placed on a very small disc of around 12 to 15 mm or so, they are small plague, are surgically inserted for these tumors to remain for a while and then remove in order to give the radiation dose locally. And the isotope used in this case is iodine-125, whose gamma emissions are relatively very low energy, 27 to 35 keV, and therefore the radiation dose does not go to anything beyond. But the sources are extremely tiny. Just look at these dimensions here mentioned. 0.8 mm dia, 4.7 mm long, and 0.05 mm thick. That's the only thickness which will be the allowed thing, like, because you don't want the radiation to be completely cut. Radiation should be able to go outside the source to reach the tumor, like, and such sources of tiny size, 12 to 20, this small disc like what is shown here, its dia will be depending on the tumor around 12 to 20. This had been a challenging development work, but the numbers required are very small. Those patients who need may have to be importing. So instead, in response to some of the major eye specialization centers, particularly the one in Chennai, the Shankar Netralaya, who co-developed almost along with BRC this material, which is called the Acuprosta, and this had actually been used. But this is a surgically involved procedure, unlike the other brachytherapy system. But to that particular small group of the patients, this becomes extremely important. Just to feel the size, like, you know, if you take the 5 rupee coin that's shown here, and these are all actually the tiny iodine-125 sources. 4, 5, 8 such sources are mounted on here, and that's what is called one of the plate. Again, it's variation. The size, dimension, as well as the shape can be slightly variable depending on the tumor part. And such type of treatments have been possible, and thanks to BRC's colleague support, like, that had been done. We also have an access to another isotope called ruthenium-106, which is again coming from the nuclear reprocessing waste stream recovery arrangement. That does not have the small energy gamma, but it has got a high energy betas are available. They are again then helpful for very locally giving the dose, and the half-life is better here, about a year, 106. Very recently, this development was going on for a long time, but very recently they have completed all the process. That's also another alternative for the same eye tumor, either with I-125 or this ruthenium-106. There are two different types are shown here, again around 15 to 20 mm dia, and very small tiny pieces embedded within this block, which could be like used for. Here the volumes may be less, but because such things are not going to be attractive to the industry, only a major research center like can take it off as an additional arrangement and be able to supply. Very similar, these small tiny sources can also be used for the prostate cancer, as I mentioned to you, a permanent implant type could be done, like, but that amount or the volume of use has been relatively very less till now, and the efforts of the BAR team and these materials could be a possible use potentially later, but right now more for the eye tumors, this has been a large amount. For the prostate part of it, there is one more isotope which you should carry home the message, palladium-103, 17-day off-life electron capture, 21 keV, producible by rhodium-103 PN reaction. Rhodium-103 is a mononucleotic element, I think, therefore you will be able to produce. In fact, cyclotrons only to produce the palladium were advocated for a long time, thinking that palladium market for treatment of the prostate cancer, like, could be relatively large. I wish to acknowledge the colleagues, Dr. Dash and Dr. Kaushik, for the I-125 and ruthenium information, and their team for the work which they have done. Again, the volumes are small, but these are not going to be big attraction for the big companies. But if you have had the indigenous source, those few patients, however unfortunate they are, they need not be deprived of that. And to that extent, such kind of a development, however challenging it may be, becomes very helpful in this context. We are just going to close the part of the radiotherapy, just to put one slide that it's all advances, advances, advances. All the advances are aimed at maximizing the dose to the target tumor area and minimizing to the surrounding. in whatever method you can do it, either by imaging, normal 2D imaging or a 3D imaging system, or you can play around with the dose distribution that you are able to modulate the radiation dose over the different volume points in the tumor mass where you are actually defecting the treatment. For all of them, technology developments have been there, and medical physics, radiation physics is a growing field, and those specialists will be able to really, you know, be appreciated for whatever they have done. Principally, everything looks at this particular arrangement. The defined tumor target volume receive the maximum dose and maximally spare all the normal tissues. One very simple example will be what is known as a gamma knife. You have a very large number of cobalt sources, like one of those, you know, two-wheeler people wearing a helmet. In that helmet, like, you have a number of arrangements of those sources, and the focus is on to the point, central point, particularly for certain type of the brain tumors, including the benign ones, not necessarily cancer, the brain tumor. This could be a method of a treatment. But much of these other superiorities are all coming not so much with the radioisotope usage, more to do with the usage of the electron LINAC based radiation, because that is much more amenable to all these methodology of design based or this modulation based, etc., etc. And there is a huge continual improvement of all the therapy methodology of the radiotherapy. One final slide, which is actually from the science principles, I think in the radioactivity lecture of Reddy would have been, you know, you would have heard it. I don't remember whether anything would have come in the nuclear reactions part. The kind of, you know, what you say, the interaction of radiation with matter, and as the radiation passes through the matter, how does the energy is transferred, what it is, what's called the linear energy transfer, along the length of a particular material through which what it goes like. So here, if you take the kind of the tissue arrangement, a normal X-ray losing the energy will be in this manner. Whereas if you take a kind of the particle like proton, initially its thing is this, and towards its end of its range part, practically the entire rest of the energy is deposited within this small narrow length line. This particular peak called the Bragg peak, this can virtually match the tumor. That's the interest in looking beyond electrons, beyond X-rays. They are all very helpful. They are the current workhorse for the radiation treatment. But principles, theory-wise, we know that if you use proton, or for that matter, any other heavy ion like carbon ion, their penetration, it will be like as if the body will be almost like transparent for a length of the thing, and then the entire energy is like deposited. In this part, it's virtually like the body has been transparent. And virtually over the tumor, like, the entire energy is deposited. That's precisely what we want in the therapy mode, that we want the entire radiation energy to be deposited on the tumor mass. Like, that's been the great attraction in what's called the hadron therapy or the proton or heavy ion therapy. But this very easy to explain in principle, but to achieve it, and achieve it in an economic manner, and to be able to treat thousands, if not, you know, tens of thousands of patients, it has been challenging, very expensive. But advances have taken place not only in the westernized world. We have now a couple of units in India also of this proton therapy. And that actually has been a very, very big boon, because as we will see, there are some very special group of people. If you take relatively younger age group people who have got cancer, by their body dimensions, they are going to be small, including children. Now, in their case, the resolution will be very difficult. You know, if it's an adult with a large size body, some of the conventional method of radiation treatment will work. When in a case of a younger patient or a child, it could be a problem. And there, these kind of a mode of proton therapy, hadron therapy will be helpful. Second is in the case of young women, cancer. We want to protect their rest of the body system as much maximally as possible, so that they can be tomorrow mothers, raise the children, have a normal life like. So for those kind of select group of patients, these kind of hadron proton therapy part has been extremely important. And Tata Memorial is getting one unit, and Apollo unit Chennai has already got one. And I'm aware that in Baroda, they are trying to get one. These are minimum, like there are going to be more. But these will remain kind of a tertiary care, very, very small. Once again, the medical cyclotron specialist company, IBA, is what encashed upon this. And they came out with this around 230 MeV cyclotron-braced proton accelerator itself, which could be used for up to going up to some 30 centimeter depths, which is good enough in most of the patients for the cancer. since the principle is attractive and there is a select group of people for whom it's very important. Even for adults, if the tumor is in a very critical part of the body where any other method will give radiation to many other parts of the body or the tissues, probably the hadron therapy could be one. But as of now, it's a very super sophisticated item, very limited in number 2, 3. But who knows, there could be some technology breakthrough others will have. We leave the radiotherapy here and then we will move to the small discussion related to the radioactivity sources. Firstly, there is a categorization of all the radioisotopic sealed sources, what we call, which we are using cobalt-16, the irradiators or the teletherapy machine, or for that matter, we talked about the blood irradiator and so on and so forth. This categorization is based on the kind of the degree of the risk associated and the total amount of activity. The very high activity and the high risk sources, they come in what's called the category 1. And 2 will be the next level of the risk array. In a crude way, it's sort of descriptively said as extremely dangerous, number 1, very dangerous, number 2, dangerous is category 3, unlikely to be dangerous, category 4, very unlikely to be dangerous as category 5. It's something like, you know, you are dealing with cobalt-16, the level of, you know, megacuries, to coming down to microcurie level of iodine-125 used in that radioimmunoassay. That kind of a thing, when you take a calibration source for a scintillation counter, where you have probably 1 microcurie of a cesium source on a disc pellet, which we are using, that will come under the category of 5. Whereas the cobalt-60 used in teletherapy or the medical radiation sterilization plant, etc., they all will come. Both category 1 and 2 sources could pose very serious hazards in terms of radiation safety. And also, in the case of any miscreant trying to create any problem, like what we talk about terrorist, violent people, like having any access or doing anything, there can be a problem. And therefore, a certain amount of concern, you will have to protect them. For example, your teletherapy machine room in a hospital is not freely accessible to everybody. Not that somebody can do, because it's already containing a shielding, but still, who knows, somebody could go with a bomb and then blast it, means the radioactivity gets scattered everywhere. That's the kind of a worry, and because of which there have to be extra control, like physical access control to enter the room, do not allow everybody. And those kind of procedures are in place, they are taken care of. But the question always comes, can we live without these radioisotopes then? Are there any other alternate technologies or other means? And that's what we are going to cover. And just before we go out of the categorization is invariably for the sealed sources. But that does not mean unsealed open sources, the radiopharmaceutical products like radiochemicals we talked about, are to be left anywhere. They could also have quite a good amount of a risk. Mostly currently, they are all in the equivalent categories. If you put, they will be coming in category 4 or 5. But therapeutic doses, therapeutic high activity doses of iodine, lutetium type, what we talked about, could be misused by miscreant. So there also, there has to be extra care about the security of those kind of radioactive sources. So those institutions should ensure to protect these materials extremely safely from any kind of a unintended, malified intention by any terrorist or any other miscreant, or some, you know, psychopathic people could do it. The basic definition here is, we have to come to what is known as the security of radioactive materials. The radioactive material security, when we talk, it's an element of the broadest topic of what is called the nuclear security. Nuclear security deals with many things beyond radioisotope. Essentially, it is the prevention, detection, and response to theft, sabotage, you know, a kind of things we related to nuclear materials and other radioactive substances. All nuclear materials are radioactive. But there are many radioactive materials which need not be like nuclear material, like uranium or plutonium. And those radioactive materials like cobalt-60, cesium, we talked about, they become. That are the vulnerabilities. One is the theft, or somebody trying to capture the material and divert it for any purposes like. The other is create a sabotage. That's what I told you. You know, you just blast one of the equipment containing the radioactivity, so the radioactivity will be all over the place. And suppose they manage to do it in a public area. However, hypothetically, it may be difficult. If they create it, that will be a very, very big problem. So this radioactive source concerns make sure that the licensee or the registered person holding the radioactive source and then using the material will have to take all the care and precaution, ensure its security. It's not easily accessible to any kind of a, you know, outside person. Like, they are doing it, but We are also aware that there were alternate technologies. We talked about in the case of teletherapy, instead of cobalt 60, we can have electron accelerators. Same way for medical product sterilization, instead of the cobalt 60 based plants, we can have electron accelerator, the electron radiation or electrons converted to X-rays, the Bremsstrahlung X-rays based units. So these alternate technologies could be possible. Where it is possible, whether it could be done like or not. So under the nuclear security concept, the radioactive material safety security is to be ensured. That's being done by the licensee who is holding the particular radioactive sources, and it's also being overseen by the regulatory body. But wherever possible, can we not move to the alternative technology? There is a beautiful recorded agreement of the Code of Conduct on the safety and security of radioactive materials, the radioactive sources. This is an IAEA, under the IAEA International Atomic Energy Forum applied. All the member state countries around 150 to 160 are there. They have sort of brought out this, but individually government-wise, they need to adapt that we will adapt this code of conduct and we will ensure its implementation through our regulatory mechanism. It's not binding on them, but it's a very useful procedure like, you know, how and what you can do in order to protect that. And that message is what is the central one. Many people might not have formally adapted, but we do act as if we have adapted it and ensure everything part we do. So that right from the initial production of such radioactive sources to its final eventual disposal, what we call cradle to the grave type of a management system by which all the entire safety security of such materials are extremely well protected. This is something like a commitment of all the, because the end users, end technology benefits are so large. The registered licensees, as well as the regulator, the national governments, will have to actually be doing that. So that's what makes it very important. And this is, there is a global concern. Can we not slowly, you know, encourage people to adapt wherever possible, go for the alternate technologies? And therefore, a lot of money is being plumped in by big countries like United States and you know, the other countries. So that, you know, a smaller country which is having some cobalt 60 based teletherapy, if they would like to switch over to a LINAC, what they may need, how they can be supported, etc. But a word of caution, not all the applications can probably be having an alternative technology. For example, what we talked about brachytherapy, it will be virtually impossible to replace with a non-isotopic arrangement. So there, if radiation is needed, it has to be from isotopic source, then you need to keep that degree of protection. So you take care where possible through alternative technologies, and where it will not be possible, you increase the kind of the protective measures for security, what is called the physical protection systems, information protection systems, the personnel who are going to be handling, doing it, like they're being put through the checks and so on and so forth. There are a number of forums like the USA body, like, you know, nuclear nuclear security support system is there. World Institute of Nuclear Security is one body, then the IAEA as the global forum. These are the international global bodies through which a lot of efforts are currently going on, and member countries do contribute towards that. And this would probably bring a system in which certain of the radioisotope based applications where an alternative can effectively equally work may migrate, and wherever it is not possible, some higher degree of security systems to protect. For example, a blood irradiator unit containing a cesium or cobalt in a hospital or a teletherapy, how to exactly extra protection to be taken. Or you need to replace the source of a cobalt 60 in a teletherapy machine, that kind of operation, how safely it can be done, secured. That essentially security, do not want a terrorist or a violent people to get access to it or create any havoc in that light. So they are under control being done, but today in 2021, if you only carry a rosy picture of all radioisotope, everything fine, you would have missed on one aspect. Even though in India we don't have a problem, we are doing pretty well. Internationally, there is this concern on the security of radioactive sources. So I thought I should include that as a part of the syllabus, and that concludes the thing of the 5th lecture, and we can have a couple of comments or questions, like then I will show you the assignments. Thank you all. Thank you.